God is great, is He not? There is no one greater. And the God that we just sang about has revealed Himself to us. You know, God didn't have to do that. He could have left us wondering about who He is. He could have left us wondering about where we came from and what our purpose here is on this earth. But He chose not to do that. He chose to reveal Himself to us. And He revealed a few things about Himself to us through His creation. And we can definitely see that God is great and powerful and magnificent and beautiful as we look at His creation. But thankfully, He didn't stop revealing Himself to us on that creation week when He put the stars and the moon and the sun and the sky, and He created the plants and the animals and created humans. But He continued to reveal Himself throughout the centuries as He revealed Himself to us in His Word. And then He didn't stop there. That Word became life. That Word became a human being. That Word stepped into time and took on the form of a man, and His name is Jesus. And through God's Word, through His Son, we not only know things about God, but we can have a relationship with the God who created us. That's the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that God has made a way for us to know Him. And not only can we know Him, we can know that we know Him. We can have confidence in our relationship with the Lord. It's one thing to think that you may possibly have a relationship, an eternal relationship with God. It's one thing to think that you may possibly have eternal life, and you hope that maybe that's true and maybe that'll be the case one day, that you'll experience eternal life forever. It's a whole other thing to know that you have it and to be confident in that eternal hope of Jesus Christ. This morning, we're going to begin a study of one of the books of the Bible. I told you this a couple of weeks ago, and your bulletin is printed wrong. That's probably my fault. It's not John. It's very close to that. It's 1 John, okay? But there's a difference, okay? So if you turn to John, you're going to be in the wrong book. You're going to need to turn to 1 John. That's a little bit further towards the back of your Bible, okay? If you're struggling, find it. Just go to the very end and then flip the other direction. Flip towards the front a little bit, and you'll find 1 John. It's a fairly small book, 5 chapters in length. The year is 90 AD, approximately, give or take a few years. Approximately 90 AD. We are 60, get my math right in a second, 60 years past the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. His life, His ministry, His sacrificial death, His burial, His rising from the dead, His ascension back to, to the Father, took place around the year 30 A.D. So we're about 60 years past that. We're in the city of Ephesus, kind of near the Mediterranean Sea, a little north of the Mediterranean Sea, just across the water from Greece. And that area of the world, it's in what was called in that time Asia Minor. And it's a very important city. It's a port city. And it's kind of a crossroads of trade. There's another important thing about this city, and there's a huge temple there in Ephesus. And this temple is built to the Greek goddess Artemis. And so, in this city, if you and I were to walk down the streets of Ephesus, one of the things that we would see all over the place would be idols, people selling idols, people bowing down to idols, people going to this temple and worshiping false gods. And if we looked a little bit closer at the culture, not only would we see idolatry just running rampant through this city, we would also see immorality running rampant through this city. And we would see all sorts of things that God would call sin. And not only would we see that, but we would see also pockets of Christians. We would see churches that have been planted. For the past 60 years, the gospel has spread throughout this region as the apostles and other followers of Christ took this gospel message, taking seriously the command of Jesus to go and make disciples of all nations. They went out with this gospel, and they preached the gospel, and people came to faith in Christ, and they started churches. And so here in Ephesus, there would have been a church, and in the surrounding areas, there would have been churches. And these churches were facing a really difficult task. They were here, believers planted in the middle of an idolatrous pagan culture. And yet that wasn't, in fact, probably the most dangerous thing they were facing. You see, these believers were facing something even more dangerous than idolatry and rampant immorality all around them. You see, it's easy for us to say, well, here's a Christian and here's somebody who's bowing down to a false idol. It's easy to see the difference between those two. It's likely that there weren't any Christians who were making regular visits to the Temple of Artemis and were struggling with whether or not to bow down to this Greek goddess. Probably they weren't struggling with that. They realized those are idols, they're false gods. We're worshiping the one true God. You see, what's oftentimes more dangerous for Christians, what's more dangerous for churches, is what we would call false teaching. It's a teaching that has a hint of the truth, just enough of truth that makes it look like it's the same thing that you and I are believing, and yet that truth has been twisted such that it is not the same thing. And these churches in Ephesus and in the surrounding area are facing false teaching that is infiltrated into the churches. Now, one of the things that this false teaching is doing is it's causing them to doubt their salvation. It's causing them to question whether or not they really have eternal life. Now, here in the city of Ephesus, most likely we find this man called John. John is none other than the apostle of Jesus, the one whom Jesus loved. That's what he calls himself in his gospel that he wrote, the one whom Jesus loved. This is the one who leaned back against Jesus there at the Last Supper in the upper room. This is the one who stood at the foot of the cross. And Jesus actually looked down at John from the cross. And there beside John was Jesus' mother, Mary. And John said, here, take this woman as your mother. Take this as this man as your son. He basically entrusted John with the care of his mother, the disciple whom Jesus loved. John, now, probably in his 80s, approximately, he's an old man, and it's very likely that he is the 80s old, right? My wife just grinned at me like I may have offended somebody. If you're 80, you're getting on up there, okay? When I'm in my 80s, I don't mind if somebody says, hey, you're getting old, okay? By that point, I've earned the honor of being called an old man, all right? I'm okay with that. So if I offend you, I'm sorry. He's an older man, okay? He is. He's probably in his 80s. He may even be older than that, all right? And so here's something else that's very interesting about John, is that it's very likely that he is the last remaining apostle to still be living. It's very likely that all the other apostles of Jesus, those group of men that walked and talked with Jesus, that all of them at this point have died. Probably all of them have been martyred. They have been killed for their faith. And yet John alone remains as an eyewitness of Jesus Christ. And John has a heart for the church. If you read through the letter of 1 John, you see him calling those he's writing to little children. If you're older, if you're in his stage of life, then you can look at most of the people in those churches and you could call them little children. He calls them little children. It's this older man who walked and talked with Jesus, the last remaining apostle, writing these letters to these churches. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and we're going to focus on 1st John. And so I say that to say this is a real man writing to real people about real issues in the church. John wrote the Gospel of John looking to the past to tell about who Jesus was, about his life, about his death, about his resurrection. John writes the letters of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, in the present, to encourage churches on how to live out their faith in day-to-day life. And then, if you didn't realize this, John also wrote the book of Revelation looking to the future about when Christ is crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords and his kingdom comes to fruition. And so here in these letters, John writing to these churches. Now, we mentioned some of this false teaching. I want to give just a little bit of backdrop to some of this false teaching, because it's going to help us understand this letter of 1 John as we move through it, okay? Now, this false teaching was an early form of what became known as Gnosticism. It comes from a Greek word that means to know. If you want to give another word to it, this would be the knowing belief system. These were the knowers. So here's what these people did, these Gnostics. They probably weren't called Gnostics at this time when John was writing, but in the second century, this false teaching became Gnosticism. They said that you had to have some kind of special knowledge in order to truly be saved, or in order to truly have eternal life, in order to truly be in the fellowship of God. You had to have some kind of higher special knowledge. And so they would come in these churches and they would say, well, you're not really a follower of Christ because you don't have this special knowledge. That was one aspect of their teaching. They were the knowers, the Gnostics. Okay. The other part of their false teaching is that they had this worldview that all matter is evil. That means all created things are evil. Like all flesh is evil. Everything that you see and touch with your eyes, touch with your hands in this world is evil. But the spirit is what is good. And we even see this translate over into some Eastern religions today, where the kind of the goal is to get rid of the physical and focus so much on the spiritual, and you want to kind of try to separate those things from one another. That's what this false teaching that was infiltrating the church here in Ephesus and the surrounding areas was teaching. Number one, that you had to have special knowledge in order to truly be saved. And number two, that all matter was evil. You say, well, what's the big deal with that belief? Well, here's the problem. This is where it really hits home for Christianity. Is that if matter is evil, then there's no way that God could become man. Because God is perfect. And if flesh is evil, okay, I'm not talking about sin in our hearts. I just mean like my flesh is evil, okay? It's bad. This good thing that God created, the human body, is evil. And so if there's a split there, then there's no way that God could truly become man. Now we're getting at the danger of this false teaching. You see, because that hits right at the heart of what it means to have eternal life, to be a follower of Christ, to be redeemed from our sins. This was called, there's two kind of forms of this belief that Jesus wasn't fully God. One was called Docetism, and basically they said, these people said that Jesus was, when he was on this earth, he was like a ghost. He really didn't have a physical body. Like you would have walked up and touched him, your hand would have went right through his hand. He wasn't really a human being. God came to the earth and he appeared to be human, but he wasn't really human. Now, this other guy named, it ended up being something called Cerinthianism, he believed a little bit different. He said that Jesus was a real man, okay, he was a real man, but he wasn't God until his baptism. And then when Jesus was baptized, that the Spirit of God came on him and he was God in human form from that point on until right before he died, and the Spirit left him and he wasn't actually God when he died on the cross. This is dangerous, dangerous, dangerous teaching. You see, what the first Docetism denies is the incarnation of Christ. God becoming man, what we celebrate at Christmas time, is foundational to the gospel. And what Cerinthianism was saying was that Jesus was not God when he died on the cross, which undercuts the whole doctrine of substitutionary atonement, that Jesus could take our sin on himself. If Jesus is not God when he dies on the cross, his death means nothing. It saves no one from their sin. And so while on the outside, these people would have been talking about Jesus and talking about God, no, they weren't going to the temple of Artemis bowing down to the idols. It sounds, and they talk about all this special knowledge that they have. I mean, I can see some of the church members there in those that church at Ephesus and the surrounding areas going, I want to be like them. They have this special knowledge. They know all this stuff about Jesus. Problem was that it was wrong. It was false. And so here the Apostle John sees this going on. He's an older man, and his heart is burdened for these churches. He does not want to see them turn aside and begin to believe these false things about Jesus. What had also happened is as they began to believe these false things about Jesus, their lives turned from looking like what a follower of Christ's life should look like. And so John writes this letter, and there are four purpose statements throughout this letter. We see one in chapter 1, verse 4. He says, we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. We see another purpose statement in chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. We find another one in chapter 2, verse 26. I'll write these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you, about the false teachers. But all of these culminate in what I believe is the main purpose statement for this book. In chapter 5, verse 13, we find these words. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. I want to read that one more time. Chapter 5, verse 13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. John is writing to people who have trusted Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and his goal is that they would know that they have eternal life. Four times in this letter, he uses the word confidence. His main goal here is to bolster these Christians' confidence in the truth of the gospel and in the fact of their salvation so that they can stand strong against these false teachers, so that they will live a life that's free of sin, and so that their joy will overflow. And as their joy increases and overflows, John's joy increases and overflows. We're writing these things so that our joy may be complete. There's no greater joy in life than knowing that you have eternal life, than having that confidence in you. And so that's the backdrop for 1 John, why he's writing and who he's writing it to and what he's hoping to accomplish as he writes this letter. Now, eternal confidence. I want to go and ask you this question. I want this question ringing in your mind. Not just today, but as we walk through this book in the weeks to come. Do I know that I have eternal life? Am I confident in my salvation? The goal of this book, and therefore the goal of this series of sermons as we walk through, is that we would leave this book, we will walk away from studying 1 John confident in our salvation. You see, there's some problems whenever we lack confidence in our salvation. That doubt leads to worry, and that worry then leads to fear. And John's going to talk about this confidence should drive out fear in our lives. Fear of not truly being saved. Fear of not spending eternity with the Father, fear of not having my sins truly forgiven, fear of even serving the Lord. You see, if I'm not confident in my salvation, then I'm going to spend all my time worrying and being fearful about my own eternal security. And you better believe that I'm not going to be spending my time doing the things that God's called me to do. In fact, I may wonder why I should turn from sin in my life. Why not enjoy the pleasures of this world? Because I'm not going to be finding my joy in Christ, and I'm going to look for joy in all these other places in life. I'll look for them in other relationships. I'll look for them in other worldliness, because I'm not finding confident hope in my relationship with the Lord. And then when God calls me to go and do things that are risky for his kingdom, when he calls me to share the gospel with someone who may reject me, when he calls me to go to a place where claiming the name of Christ could get me killed, when he calls me to act with integrity at work, even when my boss or a coworker wants me to fudge the numbers a little bit. If I'm not confident in my salvation, I'm not going to be obedient to God in those situations. And so my fear of not knowing then leads me to live a life of disobedience to God. And that's exactly what was taking place here in Ephesus and the surrounding areas and these churches that were there. And so John has a threefold structure for helping build confidence in his listeners' lives. A threefold structure. And I want to give this to you because I think what it'll help us do is it'll help us put all of 1 John in kind of a rememberable, that's not a word, is it? Is that a word, rememberable? Easy to remember, that's easier to say. In an easy to remember kind of package. See, one of the hard things about studying 1 John is that he says something and he says something else, and then he goes back to the first thing, and then he goes to a third thing, and then he comes back to the second thing, and then he reemphasizes the third thing, and then he reemphasizes all of them over again. He doesn't just go from this to this to this, and then he ends the letter. He kind of revisits things a bunch of times. But what we see is three major themes coming up. Three, we could call them tests of faith. Three things that we should look in our lives and see, am I in the faith? And as I see these things in my life, it gives me confidence in my salvation. It gives me confidence in my salvation. Here are those three things. I'm going to start this way. And guys up in the media room, just forget the rest of the slides, okay? Just forget them because we're doing something different today. We'll come back to this next week. So, yeah, I don't want them to be confused up there. So three tests of our faith. It starts with our head, okay? It starts with our head. Right belief about Jesus. Right belief about Jesus. Over and over and over in this letter, we're going to see doctrinal statements about Jesus Christ. You see, confidence in eternal life begins and ends and is all centered around the right belief about Jesus. If we get the doctrine of Jesus wrong, the teaching of Christ wrong, if we have the wrong beliefs, then we are outside of the fellowship of God. It's just clear. If we believe the wrong things about Christ, then we have no confidence in our faith. And yet, if we believe the right things about Jesus, then we can have supreme, ultimate confidence in our faith. So it begins with our head, right belief about God. He even starts there in chapter 1, verses 1 and 2 and 3, and he begins right off the bat with right beliefs about Jesus. He's going to go on to say, such as over in verse 22 of chapter 2, who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, he who denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever confesses the Son has the Father also. You want a relationship with God? You got to have a relationship with Jesus. He's going to say again over in chapter 4, verse 2, by this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and now is in the world already. So how do I have confidence in my salvation? It starts with your mind, with right beliefs about God. And as I see myself believing the right thing about God, that bolsters my assurance of my salvation. But it doesn't end with right beliefs, because right beliefs always find their way working themselves out in our actions. So if you think about your hands for a second, we'll use our hands just as an illustration, but we could use our mouths as well, the words that we speak, the things that we do, the places that we go, our actions. Another test of faith is, am I being obedient to the commands of Jesus? You see, if I believe the right things about Jesus, then it's guaranteed that I'm going to be obeying Jesus in my life. And over again, John is going to draw us back to this test of obedience. He's going to say, you call yourself a child of God? Well, do you look like a child of God in your life? You say that you've been forgiven of your sin? Well, then are you living a lifestyle of sin? And if you're living a lifestyle of ongoing sin, you're not confessing that sin, there's no increase in holiness in your life, then it's not only highly likely, it's pretty much probable that you are not in the fellowship. Even if you say you believe the right things about Jesus, apparently you don't, because you're not living out the commands of Jesus in your life. You're not living out those commands. And that is rooted in a character trait of God, that God is light. We see that in chapter 5. This character trait of God, that he is light. And in him is no darkness at all. And so if I have a relationship with God in whom there is no darkness, and my life is filled with darkness, then apparently I'm lying about my relationship with the Lord. Because if I have a relationship with the Lord, with God, who is described as light and in whom is no darkness at all, then what is he going to be doing in my life? Pushing out the darkness. And what am I going to be desiring to happen in my life? The darkness being pushed out. And so another test of faith is obedience. Right obedience. Right belief. Right obedience. I'm going to go to my heart. And that's right love or right affections. You see, not only is God light, but if we move ahead to chapter 4, we move ahead to chapter 4, verse 8, we find another character trait of God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Chapter 4, verse 8. Not only is God light, but God is love. So John's going to say over and over in this letter, how do you know that you're a follower of Christ? Well, look at the way that you love one another. How do you know that you have a relationship with the one who showed the most incredible example of love the world has ever known? How do you know that you have the right beliefs about a man who is God, who laid down his life out of love to pay the price for your sin? Because you love the same way your master, your Savior, has loved you. It's a test of the heart. And so we can kind of summarize all of 1 John by saying his goal is to bolster our confidence, to increase our confidence in our salvation, as we remember that God is light and God is love, and that Christ is the Son of God who came to rescue us from our sin. And so if we have the right beliefs about Jesus, if we've trusted him as our Lord and Savior and believe the right thing about him, then we are saved. And that salvation will evidence itself, will show itself clearly in the way that I live my life as I obey the commands of Jesus and as I love others the way that Jesus has loved me. So, if we kind of back up, we see John, this older man, coming towards the end of his life, and he looks out at these churches. He's poured his life into sharing the gospel of Jesus. He's poured his life into helping people come to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. And he sees this false teaching coming into the church. And it begins to burden his heart, and it hurts his heart as he sees Christians. He believes they're Christians. He's not doubting their salvation. He's saying, I'm writing to you who have believed in the Son of God. I'm writing to you because you are Christians, but you got to have more confidence in your faith. And so let me tell you, you believe this about Jesus, and that's the right thing about Jesus. So have confidence. And look at your life. There's an increase in holiness. Sin is being purged from your life, and you are living more holy and more holy every single day. Be confident in your salvation. And notice how your love for others is growing. Same love that Christ had for you. Be confident in your salvation. But there's a flip side as well. Because anyone in these congregations, in these churches that he's writing to, who reads this letter, and as they read it, as they hear it being read to them, say, you know what? I don't believe that about Jesus. You know what? I don't see holiness in my life. All I see is sin. And I don't see love for others. All I see is bitterness and hatred in my heart. Well, then John would say, you can't have confidence in your salvation because you're not saved. And so while the goal is for everyone who has trusted Christ to read and study this letter and gain and grow in their confidence in their salvation so they can live out that salvation with joy and with confidence every day, there's also this underlying goal that those who are false would be exposed. But I can only believe that John the Apostle, who walked and talked with Jesus and saw him die on the cross for the sins of the world, would be hoping and praying that anyone who was in that second category of having their sin and their false belief and their sinful actions and their hatred in their heart exposed, they wouldn't walk away and say, well, I guess I don't have salvation. But they would fall on their knees and they would say, I need that salvation. So my goal, I hope, is the same goal as John's goal, is that as we walk through this book of the Bible, that if you've trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior, your confidence in your salvation will grow. And if you haven't trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior, you won't walk away, but you'll fall at your knees and say, I need this Jesus to rescue me from my sin. Perhaps even this morning, God is already burdening your heart with the truth that you have not believed the right thing about Jesus. Maybe you just thought he was a good man. He did some cool stuff while he was here on this earth. Christ came, and he was God, and he died for your sins. And he rose up from the dead, conquering that which we fear the most. And he did that. He did that so that you could receive eternal life and live a life of eternal confidence. Not in yourself, not in your ability to be good, but eternal confidence in him, in what he has done to purchase your salvation. Perhaps before we even jump into this letter and begin to study it over the next several weeks, you need to go ahead and turn your life over to Jesus Christ and trust in him for salvation. And then as we study this, your confidence in your salvation will grow. This is real life. It was real life in 90 AD, and it's real life in 2017 AD. We may not call it Gnosticism. Docetism and Cerinthianism may be foreign words to us, but there's false teaching all around. And we need to be on guard as the church of Jesus Christ. And we need to be studying his word intently so that we know what we believe. So we will live with confidence each and every day at work, at school, and at home, out in the community, knowing what we believe, knowing who we belong to, that we belong to the God who created us, that we have a relationship with him, and we have a responsibility to live out that relationship every single day of our lives. Here's what I encourage encourage you to do. Start reading 1 John if you haven't already. Commit to it. This week, read through the whole letter. Look for these themes of God is light and God is love. Look for these tests of right belief and right actions and right love. Look for them as you read and let the Word of God begin to soak into your heart and life. I'm going to close in just a moment. We're going to sing a hymn. This is what this time is for. It's for you to be obedient to whatever the Lord is calling you to do. I know this was a different kind of sermon, kind of an introduction to 1 John. And yet, I believe that God's Word has rang clear this morning. And whenever we open this Word, I believe that God calls us to make decisions that would bring Him honor and glory. So for some of you, that may mean to trust Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you've never trusted Christ, as we stand and sing in a moment, I'm standing down front, just come on down and tell me, say, I don't think I'm a follower of Christ. I don't think I've trusted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And I want to do that. That's all you got to say. Just come down and say that. And I'll help walk you through trusting Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe you want to spend this time as we sing in prayer, asking God to help build your confidence in Him over the next few weeks. Maybe you're sitting here going, that's me. I'm doubting my salvation. I'm not very confident. And you're going to say, God, use this letter that was written a couple thousand years ago to speak truth into my heart over the next several weeks. Help me to be committed to studying it and being present to hear it preached. And I pray, God, that you would bolster my confidence, my eternal confidence in my salvation. Maybe that's what you need to pray and ask the Lord during this time. Whatever decision you need to make, make sure that you're obedient to the Lord. Most gracious Heavenly Father, as we close out our time here today, Father, I want to thank you first for giving us your Word. It makes us wise unto salvation. And I thank you for giving us your Word that helps give us confidence in our salvation. I thank you for the Apostle John. I thank you for the burden you placed on his heart as he looked out and saw these Christians and saw these churches that were being infiltrated by false teaching. As he saw them begin to waver in their faith, and begin to question whether what they believed was the truth or not. Father, if we're honest today, the same thing happens often in our lives. Father, things happen that cause us to question whether or not we have eternal hope. Things happen in our lives that make us question our confidence in you. Father, my prayer as the pastor here of our church is that as we walk through this letter, God, that you would increase our confidence, not just individually, but corporately as a church. And that we wouldn't merely walk away saying, well, I'm more confident in my salvation, but as we walk away saying, I'm more confident in my salvation, it will lead us and drive us to be all that you have called us to be. Father, in the stillness of this moment, Father, perhaps there's someone here who has never trusted Christ as their Lord and Savior. And for whatever reason, they've been putting that decision off. For whatever reason, they've been unwilling to admit that. But God, today, Father, if they don't place their faith and trust in you, God, studying 1 John is not going to increase their confidence in you because they don't have you in their life. Father, for that person, I pray that they wouldn't let their pride stand in the way, but today that they would surrender their life to Jesus. your Son who became man, and died on the cross to rescue us from our sin. Father, whatever decision you're calling us to make today, would you help us to be obedient as your Spirit speaks to us in Jesus' name.